and gentlemen, welcome to the April, which just seems an echo, I'll be back there. Welcome to the Joint Strategic Commission Board, which is, as we're aware, a joint committee between Wirral CCG and the Council. We do have somebody with us who I know has not been here before, who is not Paul Boyce, but is from his team. So I wonder if we could start off by just introducing ourselves so that the colleagues are aware of who we all are. Is that all right?
Yes, I do have a story that does have a good outcome. However, it was quite a and that's why I implemented this information to the Mental Health Act. Because of that, it was not possible for him to return to his previous home, and his family felt that their son had been let down by both services, health services and social services as well. Now, the point of the story is that we've now integrated our social care with health services, and this is an example of what happened to this individual with Cheshire Rural Partnership, with the health and social care team working together. So what they did when he was admitted to the unit, they worked as a multidisciplinary team. It was a social worker and a learning disability community nurse who worked together and facilitated a person-centred approach and a holistic assessment for this young man. And with that, he received fortnightly patient care review meetings. And with that, they were able to manage his behaviour. They understood then how he was coping with overstimulation, giving him some ideas of how to cope with this. And actually worked out a really good care plan for this gentleman. So basically, what they've been doing with him is through these two weekly meetings and through an MDT, they've been involved in completing reviews, and now he's getting some positive behaviour from this and actually being rewarded for these positive behaviours and having some effective interventions made. So much so that actually de-escalating him, and he's now being booked to be able to move for this month actually and be discharged. And again, this is where I think the partnership comes in. Well, I think initially, due to the family's distrust of both health and social care, they wanted their son to be out of the area. They didn't feel it was fit enough to come back into the area and didn't feel that we had the care and the packages around him to support him back into the area. But again, because we were able to build up that relationship with this gentleman and her family, they've now been agreeable and they are now supporting it in area placements, which again is absolutely fantastic because he's got people who know about him and will be able to care for him in area. And so we're looking to discharge this gentleman within the next month, and he's going to be under what's called Section 117 aftercare because he's been detained under the Mental Health. And we're looking now that we can manage this gentleman far better than what took him in initially. We just wanted to demonstrate some good working together. Thank you.
Thanks, Lorna. That's very good to hear. Can anyone have any comments or questions? Thanks, Steve. First of all, can I just claim a personal interest because I work for CWP, but I think that story absolutely kind of brings alive the reasons that we've done the joining up really. I've worked as a ward manager in a mental health ward, and knowing it's the timing of getting people together, so it's heartwarming to hear those fortnightly meetings and you know, just working together as a multidisciplinary team. But I can imagine it's the timing and all the rest of it. It's so easy to talk to somebody in the same room and all the rest of it than it is over the phone and trying to get hold of people. So it's just so lovely to hear the family as well. I'm pleased with the outcome. And I just hope everything goes well for them.
Thank you, Olna. Thank you, Olna.
Yes, so if I just come back to Chris, yeah, thank you for those comments, welcome them. And I think you're absolutely right, I think that's to challenge our provider and say, would this not have happened anyway? Of which they said, yes, it would, but it would have taken more weeks to do it. And I think that's the key thing, that we're actually getting to the crux of problems earlier and we're able to de-escalate area earlier because of that. And I think that's the success that we've got working together. So thank you.
Thanks, and I think it really is helpful to have actual personal examples of why we're doing the work we're doing, and I would very much suggest that we continue having a personal story. So thank you, Lorna. I'm afraid, Jason, we are going to skip the next one for now. So it's on item six, which is the pooled fund finance report. So that's on page 19 of the pack. Mike, I believe you're lead on this.
Yeah, thank you, Joe. Report is set out from page 20 of the pack. We'll go through the background information we've been through. Some of that before, just to remind you, the key is on section 4 from page 10 is based, is basically on page 4, page 23 of the pack. This shows an overspending, the CCJs of 1.5 million, offset by bed cave and underspend, so pressure of 900,000 pounds, which under the risk share agreements as set out on 4.9, page 24, gets shared 50% to the council, 50% to the CCG. It's worth noting, Fitz, at the start of this year, we faced a significant challenge, both within the CCG and the council. The CCG from probably day one set out a number saying that we were likely to be sort of a deficit of £3.6 million, which would be 5.6 million off our surplus. So just to remind colleagues of the way the NHS plan works for CCGs is that we are given a control total. The centre looks down the numbers and says what you think, what they think we can achieve. It may be different to what we believe is the realistic number. So from day one we've been reporting a forecast deficit. There's a difference between us saying we've accepted the control total because we didn't have much choice and actually agreeing the control total, which is a slightly different connotation. But it's worth pointing in 5.4 section of page 25 that NHS England made available resources to increase our allocation initially by £3 million to get a sort of balanced position. So that was entirely conditional on the CCG delivering £3 million deficit, so that would be a balanced position. And then I think as more money became available nationally, further money was added into our allocation, which we received last month in March, in the middle of March. So we've received an extra £5 million, which now means that we're on course to deliver our plan total. These funds are going straight to the bottom line within reserves and don't impact on the pool. And I know there's probably some difficulty organising in understanding that, but that's the condition of the NHS England funding regime that actually will be required to get to the plan control total, but that extra money is coming straight into us on a non-recurrent basis to our bottom line to deliver plans. So just happy to take questions on that once I've this presentation. The social services risks and forecasts are set out in section 5.5, net loss and pool stuff. The rest of the paper we just set out some of the details regarding the years with lead indications we've gone through on numerous occasions. So the results of the pool forecast at 10 bear in mind there's a 6 week public delay in some of the way the government's papers will work. So that we will know our figures jointly probably in the next 15 days, 10 to 15 days. The CCG will need to make a draft set of accounts available to the auditors in NHS England on something like the 22nd of April, so not a long time. And the council, I think, their accounts will be filed probably a few, about a month or so after. And I know they brought the council guidelines forward as well in terms of the external audit. So from the pool point of view, we've got a deficit of 900,000, which should be shown 50-50 between CCG and North Friday and the press institution.
Thanks, Mike. Graham.
So I'm
thinking
useful, Mike, for the board to hear what the pressure is in terms of like the number of in essence the packages of care related to that, because I think it's quite important to understand that how the pressure has come about. And then any actions that we've been taking at the moment in order to keep the pressure down as far as possible.
So do you mean for the rest of the year or for next year?
For this financial year.
Okay. So this financial year is gone, yeah. And what we've seen throughout the year has been increasing pressures in packages of care and both CHC and other packages, the month 11 position for the CCG shifted by about £800,000 in terms of an adverse movement. Some of that spend was basically backlog claims that came forward. Some of it was new claims. I think going forward, we need to be working much more closely with the council in terms of how we commission those services and move into effective what would be proper integration by way of actually saying, well, the public and the patients and the clients, I guess you'd call them in council land, need a service and a package of care, and it's less of an issue pays for it as long as the means tested in terms of free CHC doesn't get enough or free funded nursing care. And I think that's going to be the way forward, to then work with providers and leaning on, I think, the council expertise of market management with providers about how they work, how you work with providers to better manage the market, stimulate some supply, and also empower them to deliver efficiencies, perhaps by way of some more guaranteed contracts that gives them some certainty over numbers and costs. Yeah? So I think that's where we're up to. We still await, obviously, the month 12 figures formally. And clearly, if we have another hit of that sort of kind, then you know we'll be having to do the sort of ordinary balance sheet stuff a bit more than that. We'll need to go over the line to make sure there are 3 million deficit gross, and that will entitle us to the money that the deputies even dropped us. I would also make the point that if we don't make the 3 million, there's every likelihood that the deputies will take that money back because they'll say, well, we'll put it somewhere else. This isn't unusual, it's relatively unusual in the recent past, but from many years ago, this was the way actually NHS, the NHS worked in order to get organisations over the line so that people were hitting their targets, breaking even, and in the US, very few, if any, Section 30 letters where health organisations weren't breaking even. So it's not unusual, this just hasn't happened.
Mike, can you just confirm, although as you mentioned already that the extra money goes straight to the bottom line rather than to any service budget, does it nevertheless have the benefit for the CCG going forward in terms of not adding to the cumulative deficit which we would otherwise have to think about repaying?
Yeah, sure. So effectively, if we didn't receive this money, our cumulative deficit would go up or worse by a further £3 million, because ultimately when you run a cumulative deficit, the money is repayable to the NHS unless at any point in time it's written off, you know, which doesn't happen very often. Yeah? So effectively, this will actually reduce our cumulative deficit from, I think it's 13.8 million, to effectively 11.8, because we'll be making service and reduce the cumulative deficit. And when NHS even set future plans, what they're mindful of is continue trying not just to get organisation to break even, but to try and reduce that cumulative deficit year on year. So the net indebtedness by any organisation to the centre is reduced.
This is quite complex, and I think it's really important that we all understand it. So don't, if you're sitting there not quite understanding what I said, don't go away uncertain. One of the things I think Mike has said, I think it's important to make clear the expectation. If we don't manage that 3 million deficit, then the Wirral pound will lose 5 million. Do I take it whilst done silence that everybody's entirely clear? If so, that's fine, we'll move on, but it is somewhat complex. So don't be afraid to say that.
Can I just make a suggestion that it may be worth having some sort of, not a training thing, but maybe some sort of a presentation on how that actually works with some slides, just so that people have it clear in their mind, because you realise it's extremely complicated. Mm-hmm. It just be a way to go forward with it.
Yeah.
I think Matt Gotts himself and might have Kenner in the course of bringing some joint training sessions, or some lateral talk to the group here about council finances and how they work, and I'm going to talk to the group about how health service finances work, because we've realised that actually when you get to something like this, it is quite complicated. And although we've done our best, I think very early on, when the sessions we met, I distributed the HFMA publication on the different terminology between both bodies. Something like this is actually quite completely head from to say from your point, for example, how can you generate an extra £5 million? Because unless you dipped into your reserves, it would be too late to raise it by tax or anything else. Yeah? So it is quite complicated. But we work on an allocations basis, which could be increased and even reduced sometimes at any point in time.
Good point, Bernie, and thanks, Mike. I think that really is helpful if we each understand how the system for finance with others, preferably with some slides that we can take away. Right, thank you. So we'll go back now to item 5, which is page 6 in your pack. Jason, I'll leave you on this one. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. So this reports the outcome of the consultation of care providers with regard to the proposed 2019-20 fee rates for services provided for adults and older people in Wirral. This is an annual process, and it's a requirement of the Council to deliver a responsive and sustainable social care market. Proposals are made within the context of continuing significant financial pressures for both the providers and for the Council. The Council has given due regard to all local market pressures and providers' actual costs of providing care during this consultation process. The consultation covers services provided largely on behalf of the Council through its health and care service and also for NHS Wirral CCG as part of its joint commissioning arrangements. The services covered relate to residential nursing care homes, supported living, extra care, domiciliary care, shared lives and reablement services. However, we do have a new integrated domiciliary care contract which includes the fee rates on an amalgamated basis and which was considered and decided on its previous board here on the 5th of February. So this report requests two decisions from the board today. The two recommendations are to approve the proposed rates and the fees recommended by officers that are detailed within the report, and to uplift the fees to providers with effect from the 1st of April 2019. I'll just go through a bit of detail. The Council, as we know, has a duty to commission a range of high quality, appropriate services which offer people choice. There's a duty to ensure that the market is responsive and sustainable, and that we look after the care market as a whole to ensure continuity of care. It is a statutory duty on the Council. Provider views have been thoroughly considered as part of the consultation process, and this includes inviting them to express their views in a variety of ways. So we've held one-to-one meetings with providers, we've also held sessions with groups of providers where they wanted to speak to us collectively, and we've also been open to views and feedback through email and letters and telephone calls and so on. The views expressed during the consultation process have been collated, and there's a full list attached to this report, Appendix 1, for your reference. We've also undertaken a benchmarking exercise, and I'll come on to this a little bit later, and this has been undertaken across North West finance groups, which looks at benchmarking across 7 other local authorities, and that's attached at Appendix 2, which we'll go on to. If I can just refer members to Table 4, which sets out the current fees that we pay and the proposed fee rates from the 1st of April. So this is the table that has all the different service types down the left-hand column, and then proposed increases and fully effective event pressure that creates on the right-hand side. So I think if we look at the first 4 lines, these are care homes, and the proposed increases range from the 4.7%, and that reflects largely increases in national living wage requirements and increased employer contributions towards pension costs. The supported living line, which is the fifth one down, you'll see a larger percentage increase at 7.1%. This is an area of the market that we know from talking with our providers that they do struggle with retention of quality staff and cost of providing services. So we've had a lot of detailed discussion and feedback with this sector of the market during the consultation process. At 4.1 in the report, this details that the cost of implementing revised fees from April will be 3.7 million for the full year. Now, this will be accommodated from within medical health and care budget spend by achieving £3.7 million worth of efficiencies. It's important for members to note that there's no social care precept that applies in financial 2020, so the increased pressure will need to be met through efficiencies. These proposed increases will ensure that providers are able to meet their statutory responsibilities, which was their primary concern throughout the consultation process. As I said, largely national living wage, employer workforce pension contributions, both increase significantly next year, but also inflationary pressures and other factors that we take into consideration. So if I now move on to Appendix 2, which shows the proposed rules rates alongside other North West local authorities, and that illustrates the position that we are in the market as a whole. Okay, so for those of you looking at the black and white version of this, the column for Wirral is the paler column. Okay. So residential and residential EMI services, we're actually slightly ahead of our local authority. Local authorities that we benchmarked against. And I think in terms of quality, it's important to recognise that we've increased our rates over previous years to a point where we believe that we pay a fair and sustainable rate that ensures providers can meet the quality requirements of their service delivery. The nursing rates for nursing homes and nursing EMI homes, they have a slightly flatter range. So although we're further down the pack in terms of benchmarking, the ranges are very similar in terms of what local authorities pay. The home care chart on the bottom left reflects our aggregated rates within the new contract arrangement, and that provides the rural in a strong position to deliver on quality and volume. And of course, supported living I've discussed just a bit earlier. We will pay with the proposed rates a fair and reasonable rate that reflects all of the feedback that providers have talked to us about. And we believe that's sufficient for them to meet their requirements in terms of the increased pay rates and pension costs. It's also an additional amount to help them sustain their recruitment and retention for the workforce. Okay, so just to remind on the two recommendations. The recommendations are to approve the rates and also to apply them in effect at the 1st of April. Thank you.
Thanks, Jason. So if this item is one for approval, it should we deem that we wish to do so, question absolutely as much as you like. Anyone have any comments or questions?
That is correct. The rates that we pay are our usual standard rates, particularly for the care homes and domiciliary care markets, I suspect you're asking about. They're inclusive, so within that, we expect providers to deliver quality services. We do have a quality improvement team at the Cllr, and they work very effectively with care providers to make sure they sustain the quality of service.
Just a comment, but it's a very, very comprehensive piece of work and very, very well presented in terms of the rationale behind it and the information you've gathered. I think the main thing here, it secures, as Lorna indicated in your answer to Lorna, it secures quality services but also protects those people working in those services in terms of national living wage and employer workplace pension responsibilities. It means that we remain competitive in terms of our domiciliary and other care markets. So I'd actually commend your recommendations and support them.
Thank you. I just wonder how confident you are, Jason, with the challenge of making £3.7 million of efficiencies in providing that service.
It is a challenge. Each year we're delivering efficiencies, and the financial year just ended, we've delivered significant efficiency again. There are a number of areas of active work that we're currently working on with partners to deliver efficiencies across a range of service areas. We are confident, we've delivered well on efficiencies in previous years, but each year it does get more challenging, and all of the easy wins, if you like, have been achieved already. And I think the important way of approaching this this coming year is to focus on delivering a bit differently for people and focusing on outcomes and independence. And making sure that we provide really good value and we're not providing more support than we need to support to provide, but making sure that's good quality for meeting people's outcomes. So it is challenging, but we're quite confident.
Thanks
very
much.
Any further comments or questions?
Sorry, it's just a point of clarification. Sorry, Jason. Where it says in the report that it commences on the 1st of April, is that for new services or is that for people in existing care as well?
That's for all the services. So within the system, subject to approval, within the systems that we have to make payments to providers, we will uplift the rates so that all the current people that receive services and the providers will be paying the high rates from the 1st of April.
Any other comments or questions? In which case, I invite you, Chris, to have a discussion with your colleagues. Let me see. Are you happy to accept the unanimous thing? Okay, can I ask the CCG governing body whether you're happy to use those two proposed recommendations? Then the paper is approved. Thank you, Jason. So now we move forward to item 7. Simon, Healthy Rural Strategic Plan Update.
So, as previously reported, Healthy Rural is our system-wide approach to commissioning and developing health and care transformation within the place of Wirral. It involves all the key partners across the piece, our main providers, the not-for-profit sector in terms of delivery as well as ourselves as Wirral Health and Care Commissioning. I think it's fair to say the Wirral Health and Care Commissioning have driven most of this work over the last year and provided leadership to it, but it's very much a partnership approach. Just on page 31 of your packs, which is the mentions the system operating plan for Wirral. This is a two-stage process, effectively. We, as Mike's comments earlier on the financial position indicate, we have a duty to achieve financial balance under the law and also really for making best use of the Wirral pound. Therefore, we're not going to get there overnight and we're not going to get there as individual organisations. So what we have secured in the last year is an agreement for all partners to work together and to produce an operating plan for the year 2019-20, which is in line with the guidance from central government from the NHS England, that actually sets our strategic intent for a longer term and medium term, a 5-year recovery plan. That operating plan has had a very, very short time span. We had to get draft numbers in for the 12th of February, and the final plan actually now has to be submitted on the 3rd of April, they brought it forward today. What we will be doing, and will be unique in this in Cheshire and Merseyside, we will not only be submitting organisational plans, but we'll be submitting a combined place-based plan, including plan, which is by June to have a system-wide recovery plan that all partners align and agree to. And that has meant that going forward, the commissioning part of the system is taking on more financial risk in order to attract more money into the providers. So some of the providers have the provider sustainability fund. There's the opportunity for an extra £90 million to come into the Wirral system to support mainly Wirral hospitals. And we have made a decision collectively for the benefit of the whole system to attract that money. The commission will be taking on an extra £6 million next year in risk, in terms of financial risk, on the basis that we share that across the system. So the net benefit is £13 million. We attract £30 million into our system. By doing so, we then have agreed to work together on a number of areas. Outpatient redesign, which is a national priority, but it's also about ensuring people are attend outpatient appointments appropriately rather than inappropriately. So unless the person has to have hands on them, receive detailed counselling, etc., we'll be looking to avoid outpatient appointments wherever possible and actually transfer some of that work more into community settings. We wish to continue the good work we're doing on reducing delayed transfers of care, but also improve our transfer to assess length of stay and the flow through the hospital by focusing on what the NHS calls stranded patients, which are people who've been there more than 7 days and super stranded for more than 21 days. But essentially people who are sitting waiting for something to be done. So we've agreed a system focus on that as two key areas, as well as other areas such as medicines optimisation. The programme governance and infrastructure is detailed there, but actually we've just gone through a refresh, and this on page 33 is the new structure going forward. The partnership board, which is chaired by David Eager as an independent chair, will metamorphose more into a portfolio board. It will then hold a number of programmes to account for their delivery. Each of them will have clear plans for delivery, clear timescales, and therefore will now start the merger with the delivery of the operating plan I referred to earlier. This takes out a number of meetings out of the system which were not really adding benefit or value, and therefore streamlines our governance, makes it more robust and holds to account more senior responsible officers within each of those programmes. Each of those programmes will have to look after itself, wash its own face, have its own support. What's really important in that is engagement of the people delivering the services, particularly clinical leadership therein, the people using the services, and the wider communities. You'll also know how the approach of neighbourhoods and developing our people actually bracket those main programme areas as well. So we're moving into more of a programme-based approach so we can actually provide more support and rigour. At the moment, the programme management office is still very, very light, and we intend to keep it as light as possible we've probably all had experience of working in programmes where you spend more time filling in papers and reporting than actually getting on and doing the work. I won't touch much on the neighbourhood development, as Graham is going to do some of the neighbourhood progress shortly. But when we look at some specific programme progress, we can highlight there in the work we're doing on riot care, which has identified opportunities in respiratory, cardiovascular disease and gastroenterology pathways, which have come from the planned care programme, and the work around population health intelligence. So working as a system to understand what are the needs of our place are more clearly. We dovetail into the Cllr Emergency Health and Care Partnership, where place is extremely important, and I think we're one of the nine places within that. The latter part of the report shows the financial implications for the system as of February 2019. It demonstrates the challenge we have as a system, and as I said, we can only solve that financial challenge together, as previously acting as separate organisations. why acting as one is the first thing that, that guides what we need to do. So this will be developing. I think I propose that we will bring back the operating plan here to a future meeting, so that the board is sighted of it. Over the summer, as we develop the five-year strategy, it is our intention, we've asked member services to support us in this, to have a full briefing with the council, an open briefing for all council members, and then to have arrangements with both the adult and the children's scrutiny committees in a workshop style to work through the implications of this. There are also plans working with Health Watch around public engagement in the development of our response to a long-term plan, also ensuring that response reflects the challenges we have and developments we have in Wirral as well. So happy to take your questions on the report as best I can. If there are anything on the numbers, I'll pass to my Chairman of Finance.
Thank you, Simon. Sean.
Thanks, Sue. Thanks, Simon. I really like the diagram because that's how my brain works, so I can get that. So I'm a bit disappointed that there isn't a long-term conditions person on a nice government portfolio picture on page 33. And I get that probably falls partly within plant care and partly within population health, but I'm worried that actually maybe it doesn't actually fall in either of those and it risks being lost a little bit. As a long-term conditions lead, I'm really keen that we don't lose sight of those important conditions.
I can assure you we won't lose sight of those conditions, but this is